Social justice is a concept of fair and just relations between the individual and society. This is measured by the explicit and tacit terms for the distribution of wealth, opportunities for personal activity, and social privileges. In Western as well as in older Asian cultures, the concept of social justice has often referred to the process of ensuring that individuals fulfill their societal roles and receive what was their due from society. In the current global grassroots movements for social justice, the emphasis has been on the breaking of barriers for social mobility, the creation of safety nets and economic justice. Social justice assigns rights and duties in the institutions of society, which enables people to receive the basic benefits and burdens of cooperation. The relevant institutions often include taxation, social insurance, public health, public school, public services, labor law and regulation of markets, to ensure fair distribution of wealth, and equal opportunity. Interpretations that relate justice to a reciprocal relationship to society are mediated by differences in cultural traditions, some of which emphasize the individual responsibility towards society and others the equilibrium between access to power and its responsible use. Hence, social justice is invoked today while reinterpreting historical figures such as Bartolomé de las Casas, in philosophical debates about differences among human beings, in efforts for gender, racial and social equality, for advocating justice for migrants, prisoners, the environment, and the physically and developmentally disabled, while the concept of social justice can be traced through the theology of Augustine of Hippo and the philosophy of Thomas Paine, the term social justice became used explicitly from the 1840s. A Jesuit priest named Luigi Taparelli is typically credited with coining the term, and it spread during the revolutions of 1848 with the work of Antonio Rosmini Serbati. However, recent research has proved that the use of the expression social justice is older, even before the 19th century. In the late Industrial Revolution, progressive American legal scholars began to use the term more, particularly Louis Brandeis and Roscoe Pound. From the early 20th century, it was also embedded in international law and institutions. The preamble to establish the International Labour Organization recalled that universal and lasting peace can be established only if it is based upon social justice. In the later 20th century, social justice was made central to the philosophy of the social contract, primarily by John Rawls in A Theory of Justice, 1971. In 1993, the Vienna Declaration and Program of Action treats social justice as a purpose of human rights education. Some authors, such as Friedrich Hayek, criticize the concept of social justice, arguing the lack of objective, accepted moral standard, and that while there is a legal definition of what is just and equitable, there is no test of what is socially unjust, and further that social justice is often used for the reallocation of resources based on an arbitrary standard which may in fact be inequitable or unjust. History. The different concepts of justice, as discussed in ancient Western philosophy, were typically centered upon the community. Plato wrote in the Republic that it would be an ideal state that every member of the community must be assigned to the class for which he finds himself best fitted. In an article for JNV University, author Dr. Bhandari says, justice is, for Plato, at once a part of human virtue and the bond, which joins man together in society. It is the identical quality that makes good and social. Justice is an order and duty of the parts of the soul, it is to the soul as health is to the body. Plato says that justice is not mere strength, but it is a harmonious strength. Justice is not the right of the stronger but the effective harmony of the whole. All moral conceptions revolve about the good of the whole individual as well as social. Plato believed rights existed only between free people, and the law should take account in the first instance of relations of inequality in which individuals are treated in proportion to their worth and only secondarily of relations of equality. Reflecting this time when slavery and subjugation of women was typical, ancient views of justice tended to reflect the rigid class systems that still prevailed. On the other hand, for the privileged groups, strong concepts of fairness and the community existed. Distributive justice was said by Aristotle to require that people were distributed goods and assets according to their merit. Socrates, through Plato's dialogue Crito, is attributed with developing the idea of a social contract, whereby people ought to follow the rules of a society, and accept its burdens because they have accepted its benefits. During the Middle Ages, religious scholars particularly, such as Thomas Aquinas, continued discussion of justice in various ways, but ultimately connected being a good citizen to the purpose of serving God. After the Renaissance and Reformation, the modern concept of social justice, as developing human potential, began to emerge through the work of a series of authors. Baruch Spinoza in On the Improvement of the Understanding 1677 contended that the one true aim of life should be to acquire a human character much more stable than one's own, and to achieve this pitch of perfection, the chief good is that he should arrive, together with other individuals if possible, at the possession of the aforesaid character. During the Enlightenment and responding to the French and American revolutions, Thomas Paine similarly wrote in The Rights of Man 1792, society should give genius a fair and universal chance. And so, the construction of government ought to be such as to bring forward all that extent of capacity which never fails to appear in revolutions. Although there is no certainty about the first use of the term social justice, early sources can be found in Europe in the 18th century. Some references to the use of the expression are in articles of journals aligned with the spirit of the Enlightenment, in which social justice is described as an obligation of the monarch. Also, the term is present in books written by Catholic Italian theologians, notably members of the Society of Jesus. Thus, according to these sources and the context, social justice was another term for the justice of society, the justice that rules the relations among individuals in society, without any mention to socioeconomic equity or human dignity. The usage of the term started to become more frequent by Catholic thinkers from the 1840s, including the Jesuit Luigi Taparelli in Civiltà Cattolica, based on the work of St. Thomas Aquinas. He argued that rival capitalist and socialist theories, based on subjective Cartesian thinking, undermined the unity of society present in Thomistic metaphysics, as neither were sufficiently concerned with moral philosophy. Writing in 1861, the influential British philosopher and economist, John Stuart Mill, stated in Utilitarianism his view that society should treat all equally well who have deserved equally well of it, that is, who have deserved equally well absolutely. This is the highest abstract standard of social and distributive justice, towards which all institutions, and the efforts of all virtuous citizens, should be made in the utmost degree to converge. In the later 19th and early 20th century, social justice became an important theme in American political and legal philosophy, particularly in the work of John Dewey, Roscoe Pound, and Louis Brandeis. One of the prime concerns was the Lochner-era decisions of the U.S. Supreme Court to strike down legislation passed by state governments and the federal government for social and economic improvement, such as the 8-hour day or the right to join a trade union. After the First World War, the founding document of the International Labour Organization took up the same terminology in its preamble, stating that peace can be established only if it is based on social justice. From this point, the discussion of social justice entered into mainstream legal and academic discourse. Thus, in 1931, the Pope Pius XI stated the expression for the first time in the Catholic social teaching in the encyclical Quadragesimo Anno. Then again in Divini Redemptoris, the Church pointed out that the realization of social justice relied on the promotion of the dignity of human person. The same year, and because of the documented influence of Divini Redemptoris in its drafters, the Constitution of Ireland was the first one to establish the term as a principle of the economy in the state, and then other countries around the world did the same throughout the 20th century, even in socialist regimes such as the Cuban Constitution in 1976. In the late 20th century, a number of liberal and conservative thinkers, notably Friedrich von Hayek, rejected the concept by stating that it did not mean anything, or meant too many things. However, the concept remained highly influential, particularly with its promotion by philosophers such as John Rawls. Even though the meaning of social justice varies, at least three common elements can be identified in the contemporary theories about it: a duty of the state to distribute certain vital means such as economic, social, and cultural rights, the protection of human dignity, and affirmative actions to promote equal opportunities for everybody. Contemporary theory. Topic: philosophical perspectives. Topic: cosmic values. Hunter Lewis work promoting natural healthcare and sustainable economies advocates for conservation as a key premise in social justice. His manifesto on sustainability ties the continued thriving of human life to real conditions, the environment supporting that life, and associates injustice with the detrimental effects of unintended consequences of human actions. Quoting classical Greek thinkers like Epicurus on the good of pursuing happiness, Hunter also cites ornithologist, naturalist, and philosopher Alexander Skutch in his book Moral Foundations. The common feature which unites the activities most consistently forbidden by the moral codes of civilized peoples is that by their very nature they cannot be both habitual and enduring, because they tend to destroy the conditions which make them possible. Pope Benedict XVI cites Teilhard de Chardin in A Vision of the Cosmos as a living host, embracing an understanding of ecology that includes humanity's relationship to others, that pollution affects not just the natural world but interpersonal relations as well. Cosmic harmony, justice and peace are closely interrelated. If you want to cultivate peace, protect creation. In The Quest for Cosmic Justice, Thomas Sowell writes that seeking utopia, while admirable, may have disastrous effects if done without strong consideration of the economic underpinnings that support contemporary society. John Rawls. Political philosopher John Rawls draws on the utilitarian insights of Bentham and Mill, the social contract ideas of John Locke, and the categorical imperative ideas of Kant. His first statement of principle was made in A Theory of Justice, where he proposed that each person possesses an inviolability founded on justice that even the welfare of society as a whole cannot override. For this reason, justice denies that the loss of freedom for some is made right by a greater good shared by others. A deontological proposition that echoes Kant in framing the moral good of justice in absolutist terms. His views are definitively restated in Political Liberalism, where society is seen as a fair system of cooperation over time, from one generation to the next. All societies have a basic structure of social, economic, and political institutions, both formal and informal. In testing how well these elements fit and work together, Rawls based a key test of legitimacy on the theories of social contract. To determine whether any particular system of collectively enforced social arrangements is legitimate, he argued that one must look for agreement by the people who are subject to it, but not necessarily to an objective notion of justice based on coherent ideological grounding. Obviously, not every citizen can be asked to participate in a poll to determine his or her consent to every proposal in which some degree of coercion is involved, so one has to assume that all citizens are reasonable. Rawls constructed an argument for a two-stage process to determine a citizen's hypothetical agreement. The citizen agrees to be represented by X for certain purposes, and, to that extent, X holds these powers as a trustee for the citizen. X agrees that enforcement in a particular social context is legitimate. The citizen, therefore, is bound by this decision because it is the function of the trustee to represent the citizen in this way. This applies to one person who represents a small group, e.g., the organizer of a social event setting a dress code, as equally as it does to national governments, which are ultimate trustees, holding representative powers for the benefit of all citizens within their territorial boundaries. Governments that fail to provide for welfare of their citizens according to the principles of justice are not legitimate. To emphasize the general principle that justice should rise from the people and not be dictated by the law-making powers of governments, Rawls asserted that there is a general presumption against imposing legal and other restrictions on conduct without sufficient reason. But this presumption creates no special priority for any particular liberty. This is support for an unranked set of liberties that reasonable citizens in all states should respect and uphold. To some extent, the list proposed by Rawls matches the normative human rights that have international recognition and direct enforcement in some nation states where the citizens need encouragement to act in a way that fixes a greater degree of equality of outcome. According to Rawls, the basic liberties that every good society should guarantee are freedom of thought, liberty of conscience as it affects social relationships on the grounds of religion, philosophy, and morality. Political liberties, e.g. representative democratic institutions, freedom of speech and the press, and freedom of assembly. Freedom of association. freedoms necessary for the liberty and integrity of the person, namely, freedom from slavery, freedom of movement and a reasonable degree of freedom to choose one's occupation, and rights and liberties covered by the rule of law. Thomas Pogge. Thomas Pogge's arguments pertain to a standard of social justice that creates human rights deficits. He assigns responsibility to those who actively cooperate in designing or imposing the social institution, that the order is foreseeable as harming the global poor and is reasonably avoidable. Pogge argues that social institutions have a negative duty to not harm the poor. Pogge speaks of institutional cosmopolitanism and assigns responsibility to institutional schemes for deficits of human rights. An example given is slavery and third parties. A third party should not recognize or enforce slavery. The institutional order should be held responsible only for deprivations of human rights that it establishes or authorizes. The current institutional design, he says, systematically harms developing economies by enabling corporate tax evasion, illicit financial flows, corruption, trafficking of people and weapons. Joshua Cohen disputes his claims based on the fact that some poor countries have done well with the current institutional design. Elizabeth Kahn argues that some of these responsibilities should apply globally. United Nations. The United Nations 2006 document Social Justice in an Open World, the Role of the United Nations, states that social justice may be broadly understood as the fair and compassionate distribution of the fruits of economic growth. The term social justice was seen by the UN as a substitute for the protection of human rights and first appeared in United Nations texts during the second half of the 1960s. At the initiative of the Soviet Union, and with the support of developing countries, the term was used in the Declaration on Social Progress and Development, adopted in 1969. The same document reports, from the comprehensive global perspective shaped by the United Nations Charter and the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, neglect of the pursuit of social justice in all its dimensions translates into de facto acceptance of a future marred by violence, repression and chaos. The report concludes, social justice is not possible without strong and coherent redistributive policies conceived and implemented by public agencies. The same UN document offers a concise history. The notion of social justice is relatively new. None of history's great philosophers—not Plato or Aristotle, or Confucius or Averroes, or even Rousseau or Kant—saw the need to consider justice or the redress of injustices from a social perspective. The concept first surfaced in Western thought and political language in the wake of the Industrial Revolution and the parallel development of the socialist doctrine. It emerged as an expression of protest against what was perceived as the capitalist exploitation of labor and as a focal point for the development of measures to improve the human condition. It was born as a revolutionary slogan embodying the ideals of progress and fraternity. Following the revolutions that shook Europe in the mid-1800s, social justice became a rallying cry for progressive thinkers and political activists. By the mid-20th century, the concept of social justice had become central to the ideologies and programs of virtually all the leftist and centrist political parties around the world. Religious perspectives. Hinduism. The present-day Jati hierarchy is undergoing changes for a variety of reasons including social justice, which is a politically popular stance in democratic India. Institutionalized affirmative action has promoted this. The disparity and wide inequalities in social behavior of the Jatis, exclusive, endogamous communities centered on traditional occupations, has led to various reform movements in Hinduism. While legally outlawed, the caste system remains strong in practice. Islam. In Muslim history, Islamic governance has often been associated with social justice. Establishment of social justice was one of the motivating factors of the Abbasid revolt against the Umayyads. The Shia believe that the return of the Mahdi will herald in the Messianic Age of Justice. And the Mahdi along with the Isa
Jesus
will end plunder, torture, oppression and discrimination. For the Muslim Brotherhood, the implementation of social justice would require the rejection of consumerism and communism. The Brotherhood strongly affirmed the right to private property as well as differences in personal wealth due to factors such as hard work. However, the Brotherhood held Muslims had an obligation to assist those Muslims in need. It held that zakat, alms giving, was not voluntary charity, but rather the poor had the right to assistance from the more fortunate. Most Islamic governments therefore enforce the zakat through taxes. Judaism. In To Heal a Fractured World, The Ethics of Responsibility, Rabbi Jonathan Sachs states that social justice has a central place in Judaism. One of Judaism's most distinctive and challenging ideas is its ethics of responsibility reflected in the concepts of simcha, gladness, or joy, tzedakah, the religious obligation to perform charity and philanthropic acts, chesed, deeds of kindness, and tikkun olam, repairing the world. Topic: Christianity. Topic: Methodism. From its founding, Methodism was a Christian social justice movement. Under John Wesley's direction, Methodists became leaders in many social justice issues of the day, including the prison reform and abolition movements. Wesley himself was among the first to preach for slaves' rights, attracting significant opposition. Today, social justice plays a major role in the United Methodist Church. The Book of Discipline of the United Methodist Church says, "We hold governments responsible for the protection of the rights of the people to free and fair elections and to the freedoms of speech, religion, assembly, communications media, and petition for redress of grievances without fear of reprisal, to the right to privacy, and to the guarantee of the rights to adequate food, clothing, shelter, education, and health care." Quote, the United Methodist Church also teaches population control as part of its doctrine. Catholicism. Catholic social teaching consists of those aspects of Roman Catholic doctrine which relate to matters dealing with the respect of the individual human life. A distinctive feature of Catholic social doctrine is its concern for the poorest and most vulnerable members of society. Two of the seven key areas of Catholic social teaching are pertinent to social justice: life and dignity of the human person. The foundational principle of all Catholic social teaching is the sanctity of all human life and the inherent dignity of every human person, from conception to natural death. Human life must be valued above all material possessions. Preferential option for the poor and vulnerable. Catholics believe Jesus taught that on the day of judgment God will ask what each person did to help the poor and needy. "Amen, I say to you, whatever you did for one of these least brothers of mine, you did for me." The Catholic Church believes that through words, prayers and deeds one must show solidarity with, and compassion for, the poor. The moral test of any society is how it treats its most vulnerable members. The poor have the most urgent moral claim on the conscience of the nation. People are called to look at public policy decisions in terms of how they affect the poor. Even before it was propounded in the Catholic social doctrine, social justice appeared regularly in the history of the Catholic Church. Pope Leo XIII, who studied under Taparelli, published in 1891 the encyclical Rerum Novarum on the condition of the working classes, lit. On new things, rejecting both socialism and capitalism, while defending labor unions and private property. He stated that society should be based on cooperation and not class conflict and competition. In this document, Leo set out the Catholic Church's response to the social instability and labor conflict that had arisen in the wake of industrialization and had led to the rise of socialism. The Pope advocated that the role of the state was to promote social justice through the protection of rights, while the Church must speak out on social issues in order to teach correct social principles and ensure class harmony. The encyclical Quadragesimo Anno on Reconstruction of the Social Order, literally, in the 40th year, of 1931 by Pope Pius XI, encourages a living wage, subsidiarity, and advocates that social justice is a personal virtue as well as an attribute of the social order, saying that society can be just only if individuals and institutions are just. Pope John Paul II added much to the corpus of the Catholic social teaching, penning three encyclicals which focus on issues such as economics, politics, geopolitical situations, ownership of the means of production, private property and the social mortgage, and private property. The encyclicals Laborum Exercens, Solicitudo Rei Socialis, and Centesimus Annus are just a small portion of his overall contribution to Catholic social justice. Pope John Paul II was a strong advocate of justice and human rights, and spoke forcefully for the poor. He addresses issues such as the problems that technology can present should it be misused, and admits a fear that the progress of the world is not true progress at all, if it should denigrate the value of the human person. He argued in Centesimus Annus that private property, markets, and honest labor were the keys to alleviating the miseries of the poor and to enabling a life that can express the fullness of the human person. Pope Benedict XVI's encyclical Deus Caritas Est, God is Love, of 2006 claims that justice is the defining concern of the state and the central concern of politics, and not of the Church, which has charity as its central social concern. It said that the laity has the specific responsibility of pursuing social justice in civil society and that the Church's active role in social justice should be to inform the debate, using reason and natural law, and also by providing moral and spiritual formation for those involved in politics. The official Catholic doctrine on social justice can be found in the book Compendium of the Social Doctrine of the Church, published in 2004 and updated in 2006, by the Pontifical Council Justitia et Pax. The Catechism, section 1928-1948, contain more detail of the Church's view of social justice. Topic: Traditional Chinese religion. The Chinese concept of Tian Ming has occasionally been perceived as an expression of social justice. Through it, the deposition of unfair rulers is justified in that civic dissatisfaction and economical disasters is perceived as heaven withdrawing its favor from the emperor. A successful rebellion is considered definite proof that the emperor is unfit to rule. Social justice movements. Social justice is also a concept that is used to describe the movement towards a socially just world, e.g., the global justice movement. In this context, social justice is based on the concepts of human rights and equality, and can be defined as the way in which human rights are manifested in the everyday lives of people at every level of society. A number of movements are working to achieve social justice in society. These movements are working towards the realization of a world where all members of a society, regardless of background or procedural justice, have basic human rights and equal access to the benefits of their society. Topic: Liberation theology. Liberation theology is a movement in Christian theology which conveys the teachings of Jesus Christ in terms of a liberation from unjust economic, political, or social conditions. It has been described by proponents as an interpretation of Christian faith through the poor's suffering, their struggle and hope, and a critique of society and the Catholic faith and Christianity through the eyes of the poor, and by detractors as Christianity perverted by Marxism and communism. Although liberation theology has grown into an international and interdenominational movement, it began as a movement within the Catholic Church in Latin America in the 1950s to 1960s. It arose principally as a moral reaction to the poverty caused by social injustice in that region. It achieved prominence in the 1970s and 1980s. The term was coined by the Peruvian priest, Gustavo Gutiérrez, who wrote one of the movement's most famous books, A Theology of Liberation, 1971. According to Sarah Klebe, Marx would surely take issue. She writes, with the appropriation of his works in a religious context, there is no way to reconcile Marx's views of religion with those of Gutiérrez, they are simply incompatible. Despite this, in terms of their understanding of the necessity of a just and righteous world, and the nearly inevitable obstructions along such a path, the two have much in common, and, particularly in the first edition of A Theology of Liberation, the use of Marxian theory is quite evident. Other noted exponents are Leonardo Boff of Brazil, Carlos Mujica of Argentina, John Sobrino of El Salvador, and Juan Luis Segundo of Uruguay. Topic: Health care. Social justice has more recently made its way into the field of bioethics. Discussion involves topics such as affordable access to health care, especially for low-income households and families. The discussion also raises questions such as whether society should bear health care costs for low-income families, and whether the global marketplace is the best way to distribute health care. Ruth Faden of the Johns Hopkins Berman Institute of Bioethics and Madison Powers of Georgetown University focus their analysis of social justice on which inequalities matter the most. They develop a social justice theory that answers some of these questions in concrete settings. Social injustices occur when there is a preventable difference in health states among a population of people. These social injustices take the form of health inequities when negative health states such as malnourishment, and infectious diseases are more prevalent in impoverished nations. These negative health states can often be prevented by providing social and economic structures such as primary health care, which ensures the general population has equal access to health care services regardless of income level, gender, education, or any other stratifying factors. Integrating social justice with health inherently reflects the social determinants of health model without discounting the role of the biomedical model. Topic: Human rights education. The Vienna Declaration and Program of Action affirm that human rights education should include peace, democracy, development and social justice, as set forth in international and regional human rights instruments, in order to achieve common understanding and awareness with a view to strengthening universal commitment to human rights. Criticism. Many authors criticize the idea that there exists an objective standard of social justice. Moral relativists deny that there is any kind of objective standard for justice in general. Non-cognitivists, moral skeptics, moral nihilists, and most logical positivists deny the epistemic possibility of objective notions of justice. Political realists believe that any ideal of social justice is ultimately a mere justification for the status quo. Many other people accept some of the basic principles of social justice, such as the idea that all human beings have a basic level of value, but disagree with the elaborate conclusions that may or may not follow from this. One example is the statement by H.G. Wells that all people are equally entitled to the respect of their fellowmen. Friedrich Hayek of the Austrian School of Economics rejects the very idea of social justice as meaningless, religious, self-contradictory, and ideological, believing that to realize any degree of social justice is unfeasible, and that the attempt to do so must destroy all liberty. There can be no test by which we can discover what is socially unjust, because there is no subject by which such an injustice can be committed, and there are no rules of individual conduct the observance of which in the market order would secure to the individuals and groups the position which is such as distinguished from the procedure by which it is determined would appear just to us. Social justice does not belong to the category of error but to that of nonsense, like the term a moral stone. Ben O'Neill of the University of New South Wales argues that, for proponents of social justice, the notion of rights is a mere term of entitlement, indicative of a claim for any possible desirable good, no matter how important or trivial, abstract or tangible, recent or ancient. It is merely an assertion of desire, and a declaration of intention to use the language of rights to acquire said desire. In fact, since the program of social justice inevitably involves claims for government provision of goods, paid for through the efforts of others, the term actually refers to an intention to use force to acquire one's desires. Not to earn desirable goods by rational thought and action, production and voluntary exchange, but to go in there and forcibly take goods from those who can supply them. Janusz Korwin-Mikke states, "Either social justice has the same meaning as justice or not. If so, why use the additional word social? We lose time, we destroy trees to obtain paper necessary to print this word. If not, if social justice means something different from justice, then something different from justice is by definition injustice." Sociologist Carl L. Bankston has argued that a secular, leftist view of social justice entails viewing the redistribution of goods and resources as based on the rights of disadvantaged categories of people, rather than on compassion or national interest. Bankston maintains that this secular version of social justice became widely accepted due to the rise of demand-side economics and to the moral influence of the civil rights movement. Topic. See also. All pages beginning with social justice. All pages with a title containing social justice. Topic. References. Topic. Further reading. Topic. Articles. L. D. Brandeis, The Living Law, 1915–1916, 10 Illinois Law Review 461. A. Etzioni, The Fair Society, Uniting America, Restoring the Vital Center to American Democracy in N. Garfinkel and D. Yankelovic, eds. Yale University Press 2005, pp. 211–223. Otto von Gierke, The Social Role of Private Law 2016, translated and introduced by E. McGahey, originally Die soziale Aufgabe des Privatrechts. M. Novak, Defining Social Justice 2000, First Things. B. O'Neill, The Injustice of Social Justice, Mises Institute. R. Pound, Social Justice and Legal Justice 1912-75, Central Law Journal 455. M. Powers and R. Faden, Inequalities in Health, Inequalities in Health Care, Four Generations of Discussion about Justice and Cost-Effectiveness Analysis 2000-10-2, Kennedy Inst. Ethics Journal 109-127. M. Powers and R. Faden, Racial and Ethnic Disparities in Health Care, An Ethical Analysis of When and How They Matter, in Unequal Treatment, Confronting Racial and Ethnic Disparities in Health Care, National Academy of Sciences, Institute of Medicine, 2002, 722-38. United Nations, Department of Economic and Social Affairs, Social Justice in an Open World, The Role of the United Nations, 2006, Street, ESA, 305. Topic. Books. A. B. Atkinson, Social Justice and Public Policy 1982, Previews. Gad Barzilai, Communities and Law, Politics and Cultures of Legal Identities, University of Michigan Press, Analysis of Justice for Non-Ruling Communities. T. N. Carver, Essays in Social Justice 1915, Chapter Links. C. Quigley, The Evolution of Civilizations, An Introduction to Historical Analysis 1961-2nd edition 1979. P. Corning, The Fair Society, The Science of Human Nature and the Pursuit of Social Justice, Chicago UP 2011. R. Faden and M. Powers, Social Justice, The Moral Foundations of Public Health and Health Policy, OUP 2006. J. Franklin, ed., Life to the Full, Rights and Social Justice in Australia, Connor Court 2007. F. A. Hayek, Law, Legislation and Liberty 1973, Volume 2, CH 3. G. Kitching, Seeking Social Justice Through Globalization, Escaping a Nationalist Perspective 2003. J. S. Mill, Utilitarianism 1863. John Rawls, A Theory of Justice, Harvard University Press 1971. John Rawls, Political Liberalism, Columbia University Press 1993. C. Filomena, B. Hoos and G. Mannion, eds., Social Justice, Theological and Practical Explorations 2007. A Swift, Political Philosophy 3rd edn 2013, ch. 1. Michael J. Thompson, The Limits of Liberalism, A Republican Theory of Social Justice, International Journal of Ethics, Volume 7, No. 3, 2011. Library resources in your library and in other libraries about social justice.